Maurer's going to come and he's going to share with us what belongs to typically called the liberal arts, the fine arts. He explores the idea of music and particularly how that intersects with visual arts to really enhance just our experience of engaging in stories. Josh?
These had a great impact on him, and he may want to become a composer and write his own music. And so, unfortunately, this classical genre that became so monumental in his life is a dying genre. As you can see, 60% of people today would rather be streaming pop, rock, and hip-hop, while only a meager 8.8% would rather be listening to classical music. And so, for my first point, I'm going to show how John Williams incorporated this dying genre into his own music. And so, firstly, in 1977, Star Wars burst onto the scene. Was wildly successful, as I'm sure many of you could sing a song from it or a melody from it. And this success came through the use of temp tracks. Temp tracks are where the director, in this case George Lucas, would present their composer, again in this case John Williams, with a certain set list of pieces that they want their final soundtrack to sound like. And so then the composer goes off and does their own things and writes the piece. And that's how you get this inspiration of this composer sounding like these classical composers. A big part of Star Wars' success was through the use of the leitmotif. The leitmotif is where a certain melody or theme is assigned to a character on screen. And this really helps to, this like visual bond, also hearing their theme played, helps to really strengthen the bond between the listener and the movie. This is not a new thing, however. The leitmotif originates back in the 1700s with Richard Wagner, who's an operatic composer, and he would use this for his operas and the characters. So firstly, if you're writing for a piece set in outer space, it only makes sense that you would take inspiration from a symphony titled The Planets by Gustav Holst. And so here for this first one, I'm going to play these two clips, and you're going to hear the similarities between them. For this first one, it's going to be less of a melodic similarity and more of an atmosphere. You should get the same vibe from it. You could picture for this first one, like Star Destroyer like ominously approaching, and you should hear the war drums beat below as the melody comes in over top, and that's the thing that's important. So, similar note, you should be able to hear the same. It's going to be a different rhythm, but it's the same thing where you have the percussion beating away at this rhythm underneath as the brass melody enters over the top. Just play that. Striking blows on the rebels and just crushing them. So you can hear that. John Williams goes much beyond just Gustav Holst and taking inspiration. He also took from the 1930s and 40s, during the golden era, what's called the golden era of Hollywood film music. He was composed by the name of Wolfgang Kornhold, and he wrote a lot of beautiful scores. In writing for this, George Lucas took Kornhold's theme for King's Road, presented it to Williams, and said, I want something that sounds like this. And so you can see here this top line has the Star Wars notated, and then this bottom line has King's Road, and it shows all the similarities. But here in this video, you can hear it will play Star Wars first, and then I'll point it out when it switches, and it'll switch to King's Road, and just hear how similar they are. Inspiration also goes much more beyond Star Wars, as pretty much all of his pieces take inspiration from past composers. One of these, which is very obvious, he takes from Howard Hanson's Romantic Symphony. Listen to these flourishes in the woodwinds and strings, and then also the melody that comes in the high brass over it. Very similarly, John Williams takes from this and uses it in E.T., his chase scene. He simply speeds up these strings and woodwinds and then also introduces his own brass melody over it. Now, again, like I said, there's a lot more similarities and we've been on this for a long time, such as Strauss and Superman. However, we don't have time for that. So because of all these similarities, John Williams has been accused many, many times over the years of being a cheater or stealing from past composers and just being kind of a fraud and just not a great composer. And so, however, it was said by the legendary composer Johannes Brahms that without craftsmanship, inspiration is a mere reed shaken in the wind. And so that leads us to this conclusion that what makes a composer is that they have originality and they put their own craftsmanship into it. They're not like a crook where they simply copy and paste music and have a very lack of input. Composers have their own creativity, their own flourishes and spice that they put into their pieces. And that's what really sets them apart from those who just copy them. And so for my second point, I'm going to talk about Williams' music itself. There's no lack of creative input, and he's created pretty much a whole style in and of himself. So here you can see a couple of movies he's done, you'll probably recognize a lot of them. Now what sets Williams apart from a lot of the other films composers today is that they tend to use the cell motif format, where, like how a cell is the most basic unit of life, a cell motif is where they take only a couple notes, maybe three or four notes, and make a whole melody out of that. This is done rather beautifully by Hans Zimmer in the Interstellar soundtrack. However, if you listen, it is only four notes that he's using. So, differing from that, John Williams tends to write extended melodies where he uses the statement and the answer format. In the statement, it'll be the first phrase of the melody, it presents an idea, and then the answer format, he'll take that first idea, bring it to a peak, and then let it trail off. This is done in most of his melodies, however, it's done pretty obviously in Hedwig's Theme from Harry Potter. That's the statement, and this is the answer. Another thing that Williams does very, very well is manipulate his melodies. He takes a theme that he presented earlier in the film and then changes it, presents it in a completely new light throughout the film. You can hear this done in his Force theme, done when Luke is looking at the binary sunset on Tatooine. You can hear the melody in the horn and then it transfers over to the strings. It's very, very beautiful. Play that. sync, force theme, and it reintroduces it later in the film. Spoiler if you haven't seen the movie yet, it's 30 years old. There's a throw room scene at the end of the movie, and he reintroduces this melody in the trumpets. It has a much more regal and impressive feel to it. So we'll play that. Space chord. He uses this in a lot of his movies, such as E.T., Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and also obviously in Star Wars. It's an augmented add 5 chord. So where you have your standard major chord of bum bum bum, he also has the augmented part, which makes it bum 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 bum, and that adds this like eerie feel, eerie thing that he uses. So. It's in the flutes. It's very eerie and mysterious. Another thing that he uses a lot in pretty much all of his love themes is this minor chord at 6 chord. So it's a minor chord, bum, 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 bum. That's the 6, that top note. And that makes a very nostalgic and sentimental love feel that he uses, like I said, all of his love themes. Here's Marion's theme. Because John Williams has been wildly successful with Jurassic Park, Harry Potter, Superman, and all these things, he's inspired a lot of new and up-and-coming composers. This first one, you can see him on screen, here's Michael Giacchino, the composer of Up and many of these other movies. And he has a story. When he was a little kid, he went to the theaters and watched Indiana Jones, Raiders of the Lost Ark, which is done by John Williams. And he loved the score so much that he went to the theater over a dozen times while it was showing, and even took a camcorder and illegally recorded the music so that he could study off of it. And so what this score really taught him to do is how to create a cohesive sounding soundtrack. It taught him how to make melody, the sticks in your head, and then also manipulate throughout the movie. It really just create a beautiful, wonderful sounding soundtrack. Alan Silvestri, the composer of Forrest Gump, Captain America, Polar Express, Back to the Future, he had much of the same compliments as Giacchino, but he also complimented John Williams on his pure musicianship that he puts in all of his soundtracks. Now, John Williams soundtracks have generational appeal. The parents will watch the movie, hear the music, and then show it to their kids, and then their kids will like it, and then they'll show it to their kids. And because of this, over 80% of Americans have seen at least one Star Wars movie, and I'm sure the other 20% has heard of it. And it just helps to bring this overall greater awareness and more ears to classical music. So because of his wild success, there are dozens of musical analyses online, just picking apart his music and telling you how to write strings like John Williams or how to compose a melody like John Williams. In 2018, he made a donation to Juilliard, donating all of his original scores and also sketches to the students there so that they may be able to be studied and they can learn off of them and become good composers themselves. And another thing he's had a heavy hand in is bringing about movie concerts. Movie concerts are where the movie is projected onto a screen like this, and the orchestra will be in front playing all the music for it. It just adds this extra element to the movie watching experience. So finally, my application. He is an incredible composer. He has won over 20 Grammys. He's been nominated for 50 Academy Awards. He's won the Presidential Medal of Arts, which I didn't know was a thing, but it's the highest honor you can get for being an artist. And his scores are heard everywhere. You can go to Universal, hear them at that theme park. You can hear them in video games and just many other places. So all this goes to say is to not judge a book by its cover. Don't denounce classical music as lame or boring just because it's classical music, because you may have been exposed to it wrongly, or you may not have realized it's under your nose this whole time, such as movies like Star Wars and all the others. And so finally, I encourage you to go to these movie concerts. They are an incredible experience. They add, like I said, this depth to watching that really immerses you into the movie. And together, through your listening to classical music and possible attendance of these movie concerts, we can help give the classical genre a new hope. So for my project, I wrote a piece for our high school band, which may end up being played at classical concerts. It's called Silver Screen Suite. And it basically shows what I was getting at earlier with the composer crook thing, where the effective incorporation of past music into your own requires both skill and knowledge. You can't take a bunch of great pieces, slap them together, and expect a great piece. You have to put your own stuff into your own spice. And so, if we exit out of this and play my thing, you can hear that. So opening should sound like Star Wars.